Do you remember the collectible dice game Dragon Dice from TSR? Well, it's still around and still plays pretty much the same, though they did remove some of the annoying collectible aspects of the game. Thank the gods.
Company behind Dragon Dice's resurrection and continued longevity is SFR Inc., who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy. They now own the rights to the original TSR game, along with all the art as well. This has allowed them to not only reprint all the classic material, but also create new content. For a game I thought was long dead, there's an awful lot of stuff out there.
The one specific bit of that content that we're looking at today is the two-player starter set, Firewalker versus Treefolk. This is a small box that contains everything you need to jump into the world of Dragon Dice. It works as a standalone game, as a core set to start you on your army building journey, and is fully compatible with everything else Dragon Dice that is out there, both new and old.
This starter set allows you to play two-player games of Dragon Dice and includes a set of simplified introductory rules from designers Chris Shep Shepherdson and Lester Smith. The game artwork is from the late Janelle Jaques.
In Dragon Dice, you recreate an epic fantasy duel fought over three fronts. Your units are represented by different dice, including D6 troops, D10 monsters, and D12 dragons. The center of each battlefield is a D8 terrain die. First player to use their troops to control two of the three terrain dice wins. Now, this starter set features two armies, Firewalkers and Treefolk, each of which has 30 health with their units, two terrain dice, and two dragons each. Note the Firewalkers are one of the classic Dragon Dice armies from TSR's era, but the Treefolk are totally new with the SFR version of the game.
You can get a look at all of these dice, plus the fold-out battlefield playmats and the simplified rules by checking out our Dragon Dice two-player starter set unboxing video over on YouTube. And if you go there, you'll see Mo also shows off a very cool Dragon Dice battle mat that we also got from SFR, but you just need to be aware that the rollout vinyl mat doesn't actually come with a two-player starter set. It's something you can buy separately.
Now, they managed to fit a whole lot into this little box, including 40 dice. The problem being the box is so little that the rule book is folded in half, as are the playmats, and it's going to take some work to get either to lay flat. The dice are very well crafted with etched symbols, though they aren't the easiest to read. More on that later.
So to play a game of Dragon Dice with this starter set, each player chooses one of the two armies and collects all the dice for that army. They split up the D12 dragon dice evenly. Each player places a fold-out playmat in front of them, so the two are touching to create an overall army battlefield.
Players split their army up into three forces, one for each of the three battlefields, a home army, a campaign army, and a horde army. Each player also selects one terrain die for their home area and a prospective terrain die for the campaign area. This is all done without the other player seeing what you're choosing, and both players reveal their final choices simultaneously.
Despite the dice looking similar and all of an army's dice being the same color, they are actually split up into various units, including heavy and light melee, cavalry, missile, and magic. The main face of each die indicates its type. Each troop features a different mix of symbols representing magic, missile, melee, maneuver, and save. The face of each die is wild and counts as whatever you are trying to roll for. The size of each die indicates its health. Small dice are 1 health, medium 2, and large 3.
Now, each army in this box also includes 2 monsters. These are represented by D10 dice and have 4 health. Now, in addition to the basic symbols, monster dice also includes special action icons called SAIs. Each of these does something different, and you're going to have to look up what they do in the book to figure out what it is. For example, the Treefolk have a unit called the Redwood, which has a trample ability. Well, tramples count as either melee or maneuver symbols when rolled.
Everyone's revealed armies are placed into the appropriate battlefields, and both players rolled their horde army. The player who rolled the most maneuver symbols now has a choice. They can choose to use their terrain die for the campaign battlefield, or they can go first. If they choose to go first, their opponent then gets to place their chosen terrain die for the campaign battlefield.
On a player's turn, they get to activate 2 of their armies. Note, an army is all of the dice in one battlefield, not just a single die. With your chosen army, you first get the option to maneuver.
Now, maneuvering is how you change the value on those terrain dice. You can roll it up or down, but you don't have to declare which way you plan on going when you announce your maneuvering.
The opponent gets the option to oppose. If they choose not to, then you just get to change the die. If they oppose, both players roll their armies. If the active player gets more maneuvers than the opponent, they get to roll the terrain die.
If you roll a terrain die up to 8, you now control that terrain and move it towards your side of the battlefield. You win the game by controlling 2 of the 3 terrain dice.
Next, the active player can activate their army to take the action that's now showing on the terrain die where they are. These actions are either magic, missile, or melee. If you control the terrain, you get to choose which of those 3 actions to use. Otherwise, you're forced to use the action shown on the die. For each of these rolls, you roll your army and count up the number of matching symbols for that action. For example, if you roll a bunch of missile attacks, you just add up the number of missile symbols you rolled. Now, for each magic point generated by a magic action, you will get to cast spells, and I'm not getting into the details here other than to say there's a full spell list in the rulebook.
Missile actions are targeted on either the opponent's army at the location you're at or at an adjacent battlefield. Each missile counts as 1 health worth of damage. The opponent gets to roll, hoping for saves, each save negating 1 damage. Any damage that's left over has to be taken by the opponent, moving dice to the graveyard.
Melee attacks are similar, but can only be targeted at an army at your location. Plus, after the opponent rolls saves and takes damage, they get to counterattack, with the initial attacker rolling for saves.
After activating 2 units, the active player has the option to move units to and from their reserves. They can move any number of units from any of the battlefields to the reserve and or any units already in the reserve to one of the battlefields.
And that's pretty much all you need to know to get the general gist of how Dragon Dice plays. Play continues with the next player activating 2 armies and only ends when one player controls 2 out of 3 terrain dice or all of their opponent's troops are wiped out.
There is, of course, a lot more going on here. With all of the spells, the ability to summon dragons with your magic, dragons are neutral and are placed on the battlefield and attack both players, player units in their turn. Rules for promoting units, a ton of special actions, special action icons, doing all kinds of things, and of course, the spell lists. Each army is made of 2 colors, which gives them access to spells from both those domains.
Then there's the fact this is the starter set. These are actually simplified rules. Once you know the game, you can check out the full rules at the SFR site. They're available free in PDF, or you can actually go out and purchase a separate rule book if you wish. Now, the full rules include army-specific abilities that make the terrain dice more important, which I thought was really weird weren't in the starter set, rules for items, rules for artifacts, new types of dice, dragonborn, and all kinds of additional rules.
And finally, there's the army building aspect. This set comes with 2 complete armies, but there are now 14 different factions available for Dragon Dice, and you're free to mix and match forces, though there is an advantage to sticking to fewer unit types and matching your colors.
The good thing about how SFR is doing this is that you no longer have to buy blind packs containing random dice split over all the armies. Now you can start the game with this set or do a make your own faction starter at SFR. Then you can buy expansions or kickers to add to your chosen armies and get additional terrain dice. Now there's still randomness here as each kicker contains 1 monster and 7 troops. But at least you know that all the dice will be from the same army.
So the important thing to know about Dragon Dice is that it's basically a miniature battle game that uses dice and has all of the army building and collecting that goes along with playing a miniature battle game. While this is no Warhammer, to really enjoy Dragon Dice involves committing to it. Learning the different unit types, learning the various monsters, the different dragon types, figuring out what terrain dice are best with your army, figuring out combos between different factions and so on.
That's a good comparison. This is very much a miniature battle game where instead of wee plastic dudes, your units are made up of nifty dice in various sizes, shapes, and colors. It's also got a wee bit of the CCG thing with the random packs.
Yeah, it's interesting. This game, it's odd to me to find it come with a 2-player starter kit. Because unless you're a couple who live together, it's not useful as that. It's basically just 2 armies for you, because this is not a game where you can easily sit down and start playing it with somebody. It's, again, it like an army building game, thought and effort needs to go into this. And there's a lot of information in that rule book that you need to reference throughout the game. Only having 1 copy of that is problematic.
Yeah, where I think the starter set does shine is your way to kind of check out Dragon Dice and find out if the game's worth it for you, if you want to dive further. Because you do, you get 2 full armies. And the starter rules give you a good feel of the game. Yeah, they lack the details and some of the full rules, but there's more than enough here to make that decision of, will I enjoy this? Was this fun? Do I want to dive deeper? I honestly think one play of the starter set, most people are going to be able to tell if the game's for them or not.
Totally. I feel like this is a great intro set, the perfect way to figure out if the game is right for you or not. Before you dive into something that's collectible and has random elements, you can figure it out and then figure out if you want to enter into that pit or not.
Yeah, I don't necessarily know that it shows it off as best as it could, but I think it is it is the best they've got, and by far, of how to start this off.
Yeah, because it's rough, right? Like, there's a learning curve. There's a steep learning curve. There's a lot going on here, and there's a lot of symbols to learn and a lot of moving parts. And it kind of stinks that your first decision in the game is split up your army and or split up your battle force into three separate armies. Like, if you've never played before, you're just kind of like, I don't know what this does or what this means or what this is for. Why would I split them this way? What does it matter where I'm putting people, right? It's overwhelming. You're like basically thrown into the water.
Yeah, I think we were talking before about games that are best learned by the lore of people passing it on to other players. This feels like that kind of game. A game where watching someone else play through a full game first would be really helpful. Or like you're going to get it so much better if someone that already knows the game sits you down and teaches it, because this is a rough one to dive into.
Yeah, at the very least, giving someone the rule book and saying, go take, 20 minutes, half an hour and read through the rule book is probably something that would certainly help. Because there's just too much information to download. No matter how good of a teacher you are, there's just so much information. And because the armies are asymmetrical, that adds a whole other layer.
Yeah, honestly, what I think this SFR could use and would be a great resource for them is something like the Master Tailor's Poltergeist for Aventuria, a literal demo kit with a $10 version of the game. That like at least shows you, I don't know, maybe there's just one battlefield and it just shows you, here's how you maneuver, here's how you do a melee attack, here's how you do a ranged attack, here's how you use magic. Boom, now you got the basics. Okay, let's play to the full game. Now, the other problem that applies to the starter set, and honestly, everything Dragon Dice, and this goes back to the TSR days of the game, is the symbols. They are archaic. They're mystic looking or something. I don't know why they did this. I have to assume someone at TSR thought it was thematic to have every single army use different symbols for the same basic things. Every army has its own unique symbol for melee and its own unique symbol for archery. Or I forget what missile. Sorry, a unique symbol for missile and a unique symbol for magic. And SFR has kept that up. The armies they produce, the Treefolk, are the same thing. And honestly, the game would play better if I could just quickly look at any die and go, well, yeah, I have three melee sides on this and I have two maneuver. I don't have to look over and go, is that a foot or a branch or is that a spear?
But yeah, it wouldn't look as cute on the table. I mean, it's got a nice look to it. It's thematic, but I agree. It definitely makes things more complicated than they need to be.
I don't think it's cute. Thematic, maybe. Just today, I was editing the video for Mo's unboxing as Mo held up these dice and said, oh, here's a wing and here's the dragon head. And I still couldn't identify most of what he was holding up. I maybe it's just me and maybe it's a certain visual processing thing. I don't know. I've still never seen one of those 3D puzzles you stare at and see things either. Never happened for me. But
sailboat.
I don't ever, these dice make no sense to me. And I spent a good portion of our game trying to figure out what the heck I had just rolled, because I played Tree Men and the symbols are completely different than the Firewalker symbols. So Mo had rolled, I've got three maneuver. Well, that's great. I rolled something, but none of my symbols match what any of your symbols are. So I got nothing.
Now, to be fair, with a copy of the rule book that does show you what all the sides are on every die and you can see what the different symbols are, but there's only, again, one copy of this, so it's not like, give me a reference card or something with each army to show me the different types. And I will say the hardest face to read is the face, like the symbol, and honestly it doesn't really matter as long as it's the face. But yes, there are a couple of the dice. I still can't quite see the elf with the two stars around its head. I can't get it right. But you don't need to see that. You just have to know that's the face side, as opposed to the one with 2 to 3 symbols on it.
It just seems if it doesn't matter what the face is, which it doesn't.
It doesn't.
Then why does it need to be a fancy face? Like, it seems extraneous to go to all this effort and to all this graphic design effort and cost for something that really only makes it more complex than it needs to be.
Well, it's TSR, it's D&D. Come on, you need your elf units to look different. The elf cavalry can't look the same as the elf archer.
And then the dice size, the dice shape, and the dice color are all different.
The dice size, shape, and color are all identical for those units. That's the part that's hard.
I would argue it would make the game less visually appealing if they all look the same. Maybe cute's the wrong word, but there's an aesthetic there. It isn't a nice look. But is it a practical look? No.
So I personally got into Dragon Dice back when it was first released. I played with my dad, some of my gaming group, though I was the one who bought all the dice, right? Like Sean was saying about you, like you almost need a household for this. Yeah, I was the dice guy. I was the one that owned all the armies. It'd be like, you know, playing Warhammer and having 5 armies on hand in case anyone wanted to come over and play. I had fond memories of the game, and I was surprised that it stands up. I still enjoy this game. I had a lot of fun with it. Now, I already knew about the symbol issues and had kind of gotten over those with the old ones. And yes, I have dice that I've owned for 30 years that I still can't quite see the symbol on them. But it's still basically the same game. Now, SFR has added some new things to the game, and they have balanced it and clarified the rules. So there are tweaks. But to be fair, I didn't take out one of my old rule books and compare it paragraph to paragraph. So I can't, you know, this is not a comparison of the old to the new. I will just say it feels the same as the old version.
I think it's flipping fantastic that the old dice work with the new game. I love that they tried to make it all mesh together.
Yeah, absolutely. It makes sense in so many ways to have the continuity because, I mean, it was TSR. There are going to be a lot of these dice out there. There are going to be a lot of fans of the game who were sad to see it go. I mean, this game even had a computer game back in the Windows 95 days. It was a major thing, and I'm sure there were a lot of people sad to see it go.
Now, I will say it's a product of its time. It has that feel. This feels like an old TSR game. It has an old fantasy battle game vibe to it. It's honestly kind of ridiculous when you look at it, and that to even produce that many different armies with their own unique art, and the fact that someone decided that the goblin maneuver should look like little goblin footprints, meanwhile the tree folk look like paw prints in the snow or something. Like, and this is a very random game. This is a dice game. This is a game for fans of rolling lots of dice. Plus, while the gameplay isn't that bad, you get really fiddly and detail-oriented when you get into spellcasting and spending spell points on lists. Like, the number of spell options in this game for something that may not even happen unless your terrain dice roll really low at the beginning of the game. There's an awful lot of time spent on a spellcasting system.
Yeah, it's a fiddly game, period. It's a game you're not just going to play once or twice. This is a... you got to deep dive and get to know it kind of game, which, again, makes it seem like Warhammer or other miniature battle games. The same sort of level of commitment is required to play it, really.
Yeah, I think commitment is really the key here. You need to be able and willing to take the time to learn the symbols on your dice, to learn about the spells that you can cast, to learn about the SAIs that your army or armies have. And think about the strategies involved in that. You're not just going to sit down and say, oh, hey, I'm going to play this army today, because you're going to have a rough time, even if you are familiar with another army, say. Sitting down with a brand new army for the first time, there's a learning curve right there, even.
Now, again, the one advantage here over Warhammer is no painting, no assembly, no scenery to make, no 8 or 3 by, I don't know what size you play Warhammer anymore. Back in the day when I played Warhammer, it was 8x4 table was required. This is a heck of a lot less buy-in for even a skirmish miniature game comparatively. If you think of it as, you know, mass battle army game, you just got to buy a couple sets of dice or honestly a 2-player starter set. Now, I will call out that ability if you go to SFR to build your own. So you get together with a friend, you each pick an army, you order the two-player starter set for those two armies and get going. Overall, I'm kind of glad we stumbled into the SFR Dragon Dice booth. It was a game I did not know was still there. I spotted the booth by giant dice that they had set up at their booth, and I'm like, oh my gosh, those look like Dragon Dice. Oh my gosh, it is Dragon Dice. This game scratches a nostalgic itch for me, but then ended up actually being more fun than I remember it being. The issue, though, is that commitment required, right? Like, you're not just going to buy it. You could go buy the starter set and play whatever, 4, 5, 10 games of Dragon Dice. To really enjoy it, you've got to commit further. Even grabbing my old dice, I would have a hard time making a good army out of them. And I will say the game is tempting me to dive into it more. I want to pick up some kickers for my goblins. I used to love the goblins. Or get some appropriate train dice that feat the armies so that I can use their abilities better. The problem that brings is right now, at least for our local gaming community, as far as I know, I'd be the only one taking the plunge. And without local players, I'd be the one buying all the dice. And as we just learned with Sean playing the game, just tossing the game at a new player is honestly not a good way to get them interested.
Yeah, I do love that you can pick which armies to buy now as opposed to just getting a totally random assortment. I think that really helps with the whole army building. But that other problem of how to introduce the game to new players, I'm kind of stumped. I think you need to find someone else who's already into the game and then play it loudly and obviously in public and just get folks interested that way. Because it's a visual game. People are going to be like, what the heck are you doing with those dice?
Yeah, I mean, I think bringing it to the right places, you know, going to the places where the tabletop people are playing skirmish games and battle games and things like that is probably a good start of a way to get people interested, because they're the folks who like getting that kind of involved into a dice building situation. From personal experience, saying, hey, let's play a game and sitting down to play this game isn't fun. Especially because I don't have the nostalgia for the game. I didn't play this game in its original TSR version. So I wasn't even incentivized to get back into it. It was just kind of a, oh, look, there's a whole bunch of things that makes no sense to me.
If you're someone who collects dice, which many gamers are, if you just love your pretty plastic math rocks, that's just your jam, you might want to check out Dragon Dice just to get some really cool dice. Now, one thing we haven't mentioned, though, that is important is there are no numbers on these dice. So unlike some other customizable dice games out there, you cannot also use these dice as a standard set of dice for your RPGs or board games. I got to say, what got me to try Dragon Dice was because I was like, ooh, pretty dice with cool symbols on them. And look, dwarf dice and goblin dice. And I ended up liking the game as much as just having some cool looking dice.
They're pretty. Like, they're just pleasant. There's a nice tactile thing. They're nice and heavy. It's dice with lots of cool icons. It's inherently attractive to me.
Now, if you are into games, you know, other games like Warhammer Battles or other battle type games of the fantasy style, and if you like the TSR or Lord of the Rings aesthetic, this is a great game because you don't need to get into the painting and the miniature building and the set top. It doesn't take up a lot of space. It's just nice. You know, you can play it at a larger coffee shop table if you want to. So you are saving on a whole lot of the other stuff that goes along with getting into games like that by just having the dice in front of you.
And honestly, if you're like me, if you played Dragon Dice in the back and you have someone else willing to play it, pick up the starter. Like, this is a great way to dive back into Dragon Dice. And it's fully compatible with the old sets. Or even possibly better, go to SFR's website and do that special pre-order where you pick the two armies you want in your set.
The fully compatible thing here is just amazing. SSR gets a gold star for the backwards compatibility.
Everyone else, you're going to have to make up their own mind. Like, this is a lifestyle game, right? It's a bit of a lifestyle game. It requires investment of a collectible card game or a full-on miniature game. Yeah, you don't have the full hobby, but this is an army-building war game that's going to reward rule knowledge and owning a curated collection, not just a bunch of random dice.
And that's it for our review. Dragon Dice, two-player starter set, Firewalker versus Treefolk. Classic game that's still going strong, which was a surprise to us. What's a game you discovered is still going strong that you thought was long dead? Tell us all about it in the comments.
Well, they say an army survives on its stomach. Well, we survive on coffee. Help keep us caffeinated and motivated by buying us a coffee at ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop.